to make his blessings flow. For as the curse is bowed, for as the curse is bowed, for as the curse is bowed.
He rules the world with truth and grace.
So just join me in the responsive reading. It's on the bulletin. It's up here on the board, and it's also in your bulletin. The earth is the Lord's, and all that is in it, the world and those who live in it.
Who shall ascend the hills of the Lord, and who shall stand in God's holy place?
Those who have clean hands and pure hearts, who do not lift up their souls to what is false.
Those who seek the Lord, who seek the face of the God of Jacob.
So if you'll pray with me. O God, we worship and praise you for your gift of redemption. In Christ you chose us before the world was created. You sent him to cleanse us of all our unrighteousness. He sacrificed himself for us that we should be blameless. Your grace surrounds us and your peace dwells within us. Through Christ, who calls us and names us as your chosen people, we gather to praise you for your glorious grace. Amen. Okay, so if the children will please come forward, children and young at heart.
Close by me forever.
Jesus warned his friends, though, not to be making money the most important thing. He says, don't worry too much about building up treasures on earth, but spend your time building up treasures in heaven. So it's not a bad thing to have our Right? Jesus wants you to pray. Put it.
Thank you, Christy. And thank you for picking those songs for this time, and we'll share with you in a little while what that reason is for, reasoning behind that is. As we come to a time of prayer, there are some special ones we want to remember in prayer. Our families, our churches, our families of churches, our church families, we pray blessings upon them. So many are having difficulty. For Molly Purvis and her family as they plan on moving. Claire and Lee, glad that you're here always, but asking God's continued blessing on Claire's health. Lee shared with me a brother having difficulty. Lynn Reed is in the hospital in Oklahoma, and we want to remember him in prayer. Very serious kidney condition. For Rita and Carol, of course, we remember them in prayer, as well as Connie Phillips. We've got others that are shut-ins that have been hurting, and we pray earnestly a blessing upon them. We're glad that we've got Gracie back with us. Gracie's back, and glad that she's here. Pray a blessing upon Mandy Rhodes. Continue to bless and pray for her as she continues with her cancer. The Ukrainian people, those who are dealing with tornadoes and fires, and of course the rain that we need. Everybody wants to pray for rain every time I get around them. I say, well, I want to pray for rain. Don't forget to pray for rain. The Hernandez family, as they move, if you don't realize or didn't know that, the Hernandez family is moving to Lubbock. He's they're going to be starting some school in Texas Tech. Hate to miss them and lose them as a part of our fellowship, but we pray blessing upon them and help. A lot of families that are grieving also. Bonnie Brown family, will add to that. I mentioned her in prayer last week. She died this week. And their family will be celebrating her life on Wednesday. That's one of the reasons why I won't be at Bible study. It's a long funeral. It'll be going on. I'm helping with it. Others that have had losses that are going on. I know that a good friend of mine who was the boss directed hospice for a long while. He lost his mother-in-law, and a lot of people with COVID is having that resurgence. A lot of people around us have got it, maybe not the same kind of intensity, but nevertheless, it's there. So let's pray for each other, and go back if you can. Go back to washing your hands a little more. That never hurts anyway. Wash your hands a little bit more, and if you're in large crowds, of course, you'd think about taking a mask with you if you're in a large crowd, particularly in a distance away. Seems like those that are traveling are coming back with COVID when they travel. So again, little research is something that we'll learn to live with and to do our best with and to warn each other about as time passes. Who else do you want to remember in prayer? Teachers, yes. Let's ask God's blessing upon them. One of the things that we're celebrating is we have a Christmas in July, is that often churches have a Christmas in July and do a variety of activities. I think this church has had a tradition of going out and painting houses. They did that. I know that one of your pastors did that with some of the young people and others in the church. In fact, I helped out a couple of times with painting some of the houses and doing some repairs. And then also there are activities during this month of providing school supplies for children and for teachers, and several different organizations in town did that. We were discussing that in Sunday school today, how much money was involved in that, how much value there is to all those school supplies, and how much money is invested into it. So thank you to God for Christmas in July. It brings gifts to people, particularly those starting school again. Anybody else to remember in prayer? All right, let's pray. Lord, we love you. We pray for each other. We thank you that we're with each other and that we're celebrating on a Sunday morning in July. The end of July, Lord, and school is going to be starting quickly, and so we do pray for our teachers. We ask humbly a blessing upon them in the new year as it begins. A lot of activities starting back up again, but at the same time, Father, we have to deal with the reality of COVID, the reality of diseases, and the reality of groups getting together and spreading disease. So we pray that you help us, Lord, just to be sensible and to do our best in controlling it. Asking blessing upon these special ones, particularly, Lord, those that are moving away from us, and summer is a time for that too. People moving to other areas, we pray blessing upon the Hernandez family and upon the Purvis family as they move, as they ask your blessing, Father, in the places where they live, houses, and getting involved in school. For all those who have health issues, Lord Jesus, we give them to you. We're thinking about them. That's why we remember them on a Sunday morning, as well as remembering through the week, blessing upon them as they deal with their illnesses, Father, and make recovery. And those that are dealing with grief, and there are many among them, we ask earnestly blessing upon them too, Lord Jesus. Help us and let us be that conduit of help and encouragement, both in our jobs and also in our time of just fellowship with other people, that we pray with them and encourage them as we have opportunity. Now, as you've taught us to pray, we pray. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Let's sing together.
Jesus Christ to join us in communion with our Lord. Matthew 18:20 states, "For where two or three come together in my name, there I will be also." Prepare your hearts to receive communion.
Read them.
the night our Lord was betrayed, Jesus took bread and blessed it and broke it, saying, "This is my body broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And in the same way, he took the cup, saying, "This is the cup of the new covenant, which is in my blood. Drink in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat the bread and drink the cup, you proclaim our Lord's death until he comes again." God, our gracious host, we love your holy name. We thank you that you work with those who love you for the good of all creation. As in Jesus Christ, you fed multitudes with a bread beyond price. So we now come to you hungry, asking for the bread of inner peace, the bread of strength and courage, and the bread of hope. We pray for the peace, strength, and hope that your Spirit can give so that we may live the kind of life to which we have been called, a life of gentleness, patience, love, and service, as befits followers of Jesus Christ. In his name we pray, amen.
Okay, you can eat.
When we would fall, O faithful God, you can catch us and fill us once again. We are our spirits. When our spirits are low, your Spirit gives us encouragement. When we are hungry, your presence, you hear our cries and fill our needs. How thankful we are that you care. We raise this cup today, recalling our Savior's last earthly meal and remembering the supreme love expressed through it. We drink this cup as one. Help us live, work, and witness our one bound together by love and your Spirit. Amen.
Amen. Take a drink.
The Bible says we should bring our tithes and offerings into your storehouse, and you will respond by opening the windows of heaven. Please give as your heart leads you.
Stand together as we sing. Father, we thank you for the gifts that you give and the variety of ways that you give them, Lord Jesus. The accomplishment of your task and of your work, we pray you bless our church as we serve you, being good stewards of what is given to this church as well as what is offered, Father, through its membership in gifts of talent and of opportunity. We love you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
You may be seated. So I kind of let the cat out of the bag when I told you about the Christmas in July. Thank you to the worship committee for choosing some songs.
songs that we often don't get to sing all of. It's one of the frustrations that I have Christmas time. When Christmas comes around, even though we have 4 weeks of Advent in the Reformed Church tradition, and then even more weeks included in simply Christian tradition, we often don't sing songs during all of that time, and so a whole lot of songs are simply left out. We don't even sing them. There was a man who wrote one Christmas cantata. His name was Ralph Carmichael. He was a Christian music composer, and his daughter also followed in his footsteps in being a composer. And he wrote only one Christmas cantata, and it was called Specially for Shepherds. When they asked him why he wrote only one, he said that he was simply moved of the Holy Spirit to write that cantata, wrote it more like a opera than a cantata. But nevertheless, in writing it, he had a quote that people often quoted him by, where he said that the world spins on the axis of Christmas, and we need to remember it all the time. I like that. I like that phrase. The world spins on the axis of Christmas, the birth of Christ. Man and God joined in one in the wisdom of God in the birth of the Lord Jesus. And it does. And it's appropriate that at mid-year, July, we take opportunity to celebrate Christmas at least a little bit in celebrating formally the singing of those songs, as well as giving of great gifts, as is often done in the Christmas in July programs. There's a lot of glory passages in Christmas time, and that's why I chose this particular Sunday to include in our looking at the glory of God and what glory is. And there's a lot of passages in the birth narratives that talk about glory. We will be reading several from Luke in just a little while. But I want to begin out of Ecclesiastes, the third chapter, first verse. There is a time for everything and a season for every activity under heaven. A time to be born and a time to die, a time to plant and a time to uproot, a time to kill and a time to heal, a time to tear down and a time to build, a time to weep and a time to laugh, a time to mourn and a time to dance. Come time to scatter stones and a time to gather them, time to embrace and a time to refrain, a time to search and a time to give up, a time to keep and a time to throw away, a time to tear and a time to mend, a time to be silent and a time to speak, a time to love, a time to hate, a time for war and a time for peace. What does the worker gain from his toil? We've seen the burden as God has laid on men. He has made everything beautiful in its time. He has also set eternity in the hearts of men, yet they cannot fathom what God has done from beginning to end. I know that there is nothing better for men than to be happy and to do good while they live, that everyone may eat and drink and find satisfaction in all his toil. This is the gift of God. I know that everything God does will endure forever. Nothing can be added to it and nothing can be taken from it. God does it so that men will rever him. Whatever is has already been, and what will be has been before, and God will call the past to account. And I saw something else under the sun. In the place of judgment, wickedness was there. In the place of justice, wickedness was here. I thought in my heart, God will bring to judgment both the righteous and the wicked. There will be a time for every activity, a time for every deed. And I also thought, as for men, God tests them so that they may see that they're like the animals. Man's fate is like that of the animals. The same fate awaits them both. As one dies, so dies the other. All have the same breath. Man has no advantage over the animal. Everything is meaningless. All go to the same place. All come from dust, and to dust all return. Who knows if the spirit of the man rises upward, and if the spirit of the animal goes downward into the earth? So I saw that there is nothing better for a man than to enjoy his work, because that is his lot. Or who can bring him to see what will happen after him? Time. Time is an unusual thing. Time takes time. It's an old cliche that I enjoy very, very much. Time takes time. God takes his time. Have you ever noticed that? Both in the Bible and in history and in your life, that God takes time. in the grief share and the life after loss that I'm doing, and we're continuing that on Wednesday nights at Asbury United Methodist Church, and then we'll continue with grief share at Home Hospice starting in August. Someone asked, even this week, got a pretty good group that's attending and a variety of different losses that have taken place. One of them asked, you know, my loss of my wife was almost a year ago, and I'm just really now kind of catching my balance. Boy, it takes a lot of time to deal with this, doesn't it? And I had to admit to him, yes, it does. You've noticed that. God takes time. And his question was, why does it have to take so long? That's a good question. God took his time to take his people into the promised land, a long time. Jacob had to have his experience and his sons. Joseph had to get out of prison, and it took time to get him there. To deliver them from Egypt, it took a long time. 40 years in the wilderness, in traveling. The conquering of the promised land took time. The time of the judges was a long period of time before finally they came to the kingdom. And then there was the divided kingdom, and it took a long time for the divided kingdom finally to find peace and settle. Then Israel went into the Babylonian exile, 70 years. And then there was the waiting on the Messiah. From David until Jesus was 1,000 years. Promised as the deliverer that would come out of the tribe of Benjamin, out of David. There's this beautiful scene found in the made-for-television series Jesus of Nazareth, a long episode in which the Romans had come into a city, and the Romans took the bread and took everything that they wanted as they passed through the legions, as is custom and is allowed in Roman law. Everybody is upset, and a couple of the zealots come out of the temple and they fall on their knees and they lift their hands up and just crying out, "How long, O Lord, how long will you let this go on until you deliver us by the Messiah?" That's the same feeling that you and I have as we have to deal with all kinds of things. Jesus had to grow to ministry. 30 years he had to grow up before he started his 3-year ministry. 9 hours on the cross, 7 sayings. 9 hours to die. The growth of the church from 4 BC until 400 AD continued to experience all kinds of pivots. Somebody asked me the other day at Bible study, wasn't it, Don? They asked and talked. They said, "What do you think is happening with the church?" And my response was, "Is that we're in a pivot. We don't really know where we're going to end up with this." The pivot church is in a pivot. Is the church over with? There are many who would delight to say so. There would be many who would delight to write papers about it. But of course, they have to date their paper in the year of our Lord, 2022. No, God's not through with the church. He's not through with us. But it's pivoting. There's differences that are going on. To deliver you and I from all the things that we experienced, it took time, did it not, to deliver us. To deliver you and I from COVID. It's taking time. We're tired of hearing about it. We're tired of it being around. There will come a day, and I really believe so, that we'll actually say to our great-great-grandchildren, "They have COVID down the street. Y'all go down there and play with them." You know, just like they did with measles and mumps, you know. Go down there and play with them. Catch it and get it over with before school starts. That'll come. Everything has its time, but it takes time. He takes his time in our lives, doesn't he, to deliver us. An activity or a difficulty comes upon us, a burden that we have to face, and God takes his time. He takes his time healing us, doesn't he, Claire? Takes his time. It doesn't just heal automatically. Rather, it has to take its time. The body has to take its time to be healed. And now we are waiting for the second coming. 4 BC until 2022, and Jesus hasn't come back yet. We're still waiting. God is taking his time. There are some, and you experience them also, who say, you know, I know the Lord Jesus is going to come back real soon, and I'm ready for him. And I would agree with you, and then with them, I would say, I'm ready whenever he's ready to come back. But at the same time, there's still a few things that need to be done. And there's still a few people that I have come in contact with and you've come in contact with and that we've shared with, and they haven't quite yet come to the place that they understand the gospel yet. It takes time. It takes time for a child to grow up to the place that they receive Christ. A longtime agnostic professor attended a man's church, and then finally one day he suddenly became very active and very faithful in all the things that were going on in the church. Very attentive, taking notes, growing, even wanting to work in the church. Pastor was kind of mystified by it, and he finally asked him one day, he said, when did you become a Christian? And the professor responded, somewhere reading Luke, I became a Christian. Well, that's the glory of God coming into us. So I want us to read some passages out of the book of Luke, that which is the Christmas story, beginning in Luke chapter 1, verse 67. Luke chapter 1, beginning with verse 67. His father Zechariah was filled with the Holy Spirit and prophesied, praise be to the Lord and God of Israel, because he has come and has redeemed his people. He has raised up a horn of his salvation for us in the house of his servant David. As he said through his holy prophets of long ago, salvation from our enemies and from the hand of all who hate us, to show mercy to our fathers, to remember his holy covenant, the oath he swore to our father Abraham, to rescue us from the hand of our enemies and to enable us to serve him without fear, in holiness and righteousness before him all of our days. And to you, my child, will be called a prophet of the Most High, for you will go on before the Lord to prepare the way for him, to give his people the knowledge of salvation through the forgiveness of their sins, because of the tender mercy of our God, of which the rising sun will come to us from heaven, to shine on those living in darkness and in the shadow of death, to guide our feet into the path of peace. And the child grew and became strong in spirit and lived in the desert until he appeared publicly to Israel. The promise of John the prophet. We are delivered to serve God without fear, the prophet prophesied. To serve God without fear and to serve him knowing that he will, in holiness and righteousness, deliver us. We are both brought glory to and we bring glory to God all the days of our lives. Bringing God glory is a part of what you and I were created to do. Now from Luke, also, second chapter, beginning with the 8th verse. And there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them. And they were terrified. The angel said to them, do not be afraid. I will bring you good news of great joy, which will be for all people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is Christ the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find the baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger. Suddenly a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to men on whom his favor rests. Glory to God shone round about them. What was that glory that shone round about them? You and I, when we do a Christmas play, a spotlight comes on, and glory shines around them. Well, glory is not just light or a shining of some kind of brightness. Glory is a presence. The glory that shone around them was a sensitivity that they felt and they understood, both intellectually and emotionally. They sensed God's presence. And that same glory is given to you, and God glorifies himself through you in the place where you work, people that you work with, place that you do business, where you play, where you shop. The glory of God can actually appear there too. A presence of God that makes people aware that God is there. That's glory. It's not a light that shines, but rather it is a true presence that shines out of you, that same presence that shone when the angels appeared. All were aware that something had happened, something unique. There was a great glory given, And that great glory of God and peace to men who love God and carry this glory with them becomes a commission. A commission to share as we are going. Look in the rest of that chapter, or the rest of those few verses. When the angels had left them and gone to heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about." So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby who was lying in the manger. And when they had seen him, they spread the word concerning him that had been told them about this child. And all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. But Mary treasured up all these things and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things that they had heard and seen, which were just as they had been told. You and I get the glorious privilege of being able to bring that kind of glory. And that glory still remains. I love it when there is a wonderful meeting of believers and there is a special touching upon those believers in those meeting and there is a special presence of God, because you can actually go back in the place and sometimes sense and feel the remnant of that glory that was still there. It's one of the reasons why you and I have special places that we consider holy places that we go to. They may be holy places where you go and pray. I have four or five that are here in town, special places to me, that are just places where I sense the glory of God. And maybe that glory is reminiscent, left over perhaps, from people who've been praying or people who experienced God's presence in those places. Nevertheless, it was where I experienced God's presence in those places. And when I go to those places, there's still a sensing of the glory of God present there. The presence, the personality, the character of God. And the same thing is true when we go out into a place where we visit with people who are special to us and that we know are genuine believers, our sanctuary, our fellowship hall, our Sunday school. You walk into it, you can sense its presence, sense the presence of people. I do. Even this last week, I had opportunity after our Bible study. We finished our Bible study. My day was certainly not over. All of a sudden, I had several people come to see me here. One was a person needing to talk to me about a funeral. And I said, "Well, I'm at the church. Go ahead and come on up here, and we'll talk about the funeral." So he came, and we talked about his wife and the glorious presence that she was in his life. We had that funeral yesterday over in Monahans. Talked about the family that I've been with before. And then shortly after that, somebody else showed up and needed to talk. And I said, "All right." I didn't plan on spending my day at the church, but go ahead, sit down and let's talk. And we talked. And then after he left, I just walked around the church a little while. In between the time of that first guest and that second guest coming, I walked around the church a little while. And I'll do that every once in a while, and you do too, because you sense the glory. The glory in the presence, because God's glory has been here and is here in your life and in my life, and he continues to be with us in worship, and there are times that we even go back to the place and celebrate that glory. I had a pastor friend one time do a strange thing with me. He was a pastor over at Sherwood Baptist Church, and I was a young person there and had made a decision to become a minister. I was 14, and he let me preach my first sermon. No, you don't want to hear it. I thought it was wonderful. And I preached on the second coming of Jesus. That's what I preached on. Never forget it, and got it on tape even. But I went up to the pastor and I said, "You know, I believe I'm ready. It's been almost a year." For a young person, that's a long time. "It's been almost a year since I made my decision to become a minister, and so I'm ready to preach a sermon." So he let me read 8 books. He gave me 8 books to read. I read them very quickly and got them back to them. And then he said, "Okay, you write your sermon, bring it to me, and I'll grade it." I thought that was very presumptuous on the part of somebody else wanting to grade my sermons, since Billy Graham's been stealing them since I was 14, I noticed. And so I went and I said, "Here's my sermon," and he bled all over it. I mean, it was... he put red ink all over it and had me correct it. And then finally he gave me the day when I was to preach. It was coming. And he said, "You have one more thing to do." Now, I thought this pastor was the meanest man in the world. And he and I always had conflict throughout our lives. He's now with the Lord himself. But he and I just had conflict constantly. But he was a great disciplinarian. And he disciplined me well. And he said, Jimmy, you need to do one more thing. And I said, what is that? And he said, I want you to go come up here during this week before you preach the sermon on 2 days. I want you to pick 2 days, and I want you to come up here, and I want you to preach that sermon in the sanctuary. I thought, what a stupid thing to do. You know, the sermon's perfect. I wrote it. I thought, I will preach it when it's time to preach. And he said, you need to practice it. And so I want you to come up and I want you to practice preaching by preaching to, I said, an empty sanctuary. Are you going to be in there? He said, no, it'll be an empty sanctuary. There will be no one in there. He said, you're going to learn two lessons. One is that it is God who inspired the message, and that message is an important message, even if it's some roaches that are listening over in a corner somewhere. He said, preaching that message is important, and it is significant because you're doing it for Him. You're doing it for Him. He said, don't you forget what's going on here. I mean, who is the audience today? God. And who are the performers? You are the performers. I'm the initiator. I'm kind of like the play director. You pray. You're next. You are the performers. And God is the audience, and He is listening, and He is contemplating. He is getting glory from you and dispelling glory back to you. But He taught me another lesson, and that was that when you are glorifying God, it doesn't matter whether somebody's present or not. The glory is the same. And that in that place, and that's one of my places to go and pray, in that place there is a presence of God because the people of God meet there. And the glory of God remains. Much as it did in the temple, much as it did in the tabernacle when the Ten Commandments and the Ark of the Covenant were there. The glory of the Lord was there. The glory of the Lord is here. The glory of the Lord is shining through you. And that glory of the Lord finally shines even in the place where you live and work. On the eighth day, when it was time to circumcise him, he was named Jesus, the name of the angel that had given him before he had been conceived. And when the time of their purification according to the law of Moses had been completed, Joseph and Mary took him to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord. As it is written in the law of the Lord, every firstborn male is to be circumcised to the Lord, and to offer a sacrifice in keeping with what is said in the law of the Lord, a pair of turtle doves and 2 young pigeons. Now there was a man in Jerusalem called Simon, who was righteous and devout, and he was waiting on the consolation of Israel. And the Holy Spirit was upon him, and there had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not die before he had seen the Lord Christ. Moved by the Spirit, he went into the temple courts, and the parents brought in the child Jesus to do for him what was the custom of the law requiring. Simon took him in his arms and, praising God, saying, Sovereign Lord, as you have promised, now dismiss your servant in peace. For my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared in the sight of all the people, a light for the revelation to the Gentiles and for the glory of your people, Israel. A light to the world to finally bring glory, meaning, and purpose to the struggle and faith of Israel over all those years. You and I have to wait on God too, and it's not easy. We're to glorify Him by reflecting His character, function as the body of Christ, and to proclaim and reflect His purpose and His meaning in life, to keep His presence through us alive and present. Your presence. You become the reflection of the glory of God wherever you go. And it means a great deal to other people. One of the reasons why I enjoy memorial services is not just in remembering a person, but remembering, by that remembering the glory that they brought to other lives. And it's a beautiful thing to have other people give testimony to what that person meant to them. And often it's hard to describe. They could describe it in things that were done. They could describe it in the favorite foods that were cooked by that person, or something made, or something given. But the most beautiful thing is when they describe simply being in the presence of that person. And usually that's what's included. That person's presence brought meaning to their life. And almost always, because I do too many funerals, almost always those people were devoted Christian people. Now, there are those funerals where it's almost just a party. And there is no real remembering. They're simply people thinking about themselves. And usually that case is somebody who was not a believer. What do we remember about a person? The glory that God shone through them. The glory of Christ revealed through them to others. That's what we remember. That's what makes all the difference. As we wait on God, 1 Corinthians 13 says that we wait in faith, hope, and love. Faith and love, faith and hope tell us why, and love tells us what. What we're going to do now. Romans 8, 37 through 39 says, don't look at what the world is coming to, but look what has come into the world. We're called to be His people of prayer, and when the world is in pain, we are to wait on the Holy Spirit, to let His Spirit groan through us and groan with us for healing to take place. For God's presence to come through that prayer and to heal people, to make their lives glorified also as we have been glorified by serving God. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, Your glory has come upon us, and that glory is to be revealed to the rest of the world through us. And Father, often we forget that. We think that the world doesn't notice. And we spend a lot of time encouraging children and others to find the meaning that they have, the purpose that they have, and the reason why they're alive, and what God is doing through them. But Lord, what You're doing through them is revealing Yourself. When they reflect You, we are accomplishing what we need to accomplish. As we contemplate in this time of music, Lord, what we pray is that You'll help us to think about our presence and our work in the world, that presence is Your presence, Your work in the world, we pray in Jesus' name. As you pray,
above. I am the light of the world.